Well, from his perspective, of course, he's done everything right. There's no doubt about that. No, I mean, what he's shown himself to be is a very shrewd political operator. If you look over the 10 years that he's been in power, you know, his first 5 years, essentially, he moved to make sure that he controlled the party and the party controlled as much of politics as possible. And then he set about refocusing economic activity in a less market-oriented direction, much more towards straight dominance and state control. And then most recently, you know, he's been able to confirm his power by reorganizing intelligence services, which was perhaps one of the last areas that he didn't have complete control over. So he's shown himself to be a very adept politician. He clearly believes he has a vision for China domestically and internationally that works well and will serve China. But what are the disadvantages of that? I think I can see a couple, at least. First is whether such an economic strategy can be successful in delivering the growth that China needs to keep moving forward. Currently, it probably won't deliver very effective growth because it's going to direct scarce resources to the less profitable parts of the economy. On the political side, I think if you look at the people who are now being promoted, they all tend to be followers and supporters of Xi. They don't seem to be there because of their technical expertise. And I think that is a problem because post-Congress, China is going to face very significant policy challenges. And if they're basically apparatchiks and bureaucrats, is anybody going to stand up to Xi Jinping and say, look, this isn't working, we need to change? It's what I've referred to as the kind of Putin syndrome, that no one dares say, you know, you need to correct course or you're wrong. And then the last thing I would say on that is, it really pushes the whole question of succession far off into the future. It's quite clear Xi intends to stay certainly till 2035 and perhaps even beyond. And that makes the system unstable. And I wonder really at China's current level of development, more advanced economy, more sophisticated society, is the concentration of power increasingly in the hands of one person the right thing? And I think that can be destabilizing. Well, I think the first thing is there's been no surprises. I mean, pretty much what was going to happen was mapped out before they met. The key themes for the General Secretary's speech, you know, security, common prosperity, the paramount role of the party, the new development model, all those things have been sketched out before. And if you look at the kind of four functions that the Congress has, you know, one is that report. Second, of course, is the report and leadership of the Discipline Inspection Commission, which is important to see. And then thirdly is, you know, beginning to appoint the new leadership of the Communist Party and changes in the Constitution. And what we've seen over the week has been that in all four of those areas, the outcomes are strongly supporting Xi Jinping and his claims to continue as the paramount leader well into the future, and I suspect well beyond the next 5 years. No, I think, you know, you have to remember though, in China, you know, programs are often slogans rather than having any detail to them. And so the Belt and Road never really had a very highly specified program that it was going to follow. Initially, as you know, it was set up to deal with the surplus capacity in the Chinese economy following the stimulus investments after the 08-09 financial crisis. So you saw a lot of infrastructure being built, exported. But now you've seen pushback in a number of countries about the debt levels, the service levels. So I think that they are refocusing the BRI to serve the current interests of China. And I think those are twofold. One is exporting green technologies, and the other is exporting what Xi Jinping sees as the kind of cutting edge advanced technologies in computing, biotech, AI, and so forth. And I think that's something that China is trying to focus on, that I think they feel that genuine power lies with those countries that set standards in the advanced industries for the future. So I think that's where they're trying to shift BRI to. But has it been successful? I think it's been a mixed bag, and I think it depends which country you look at it from. It certainly hasn't become the overwhelming dominant exporting force that some people perhaps thought when it was launched. No, I don't believe that. I mean, I don't think there's any clear evidence that there was a conscious debt trap diplomacy. I mean, you could say there was some stupidity because these were all already heavily indebted countries. And so sort of piling up more debt, you know, you could have seen that this eventually is going to create problems in terms of repayment. But unlike some people who do see it directly as debt trap diplomacy, I don't see a conscious attempt to use the debt then to blackmail these countries into supporting China's positions. I mean, I do think it's true that they definitely use sort of trade and investment to try and win support from other countries, but I don't see it as a specific objective of the BRI. That's an interesting question, and I think it does at some level run counter to China's interests in terms of presenting it as a warm, fuzzy, friendly country that's going to help you develop. But I think it really relates to a deeper strain within Xi Jinping's thinking that first he wants China to move from being a rule taker, as he calls it, to a rule maker. And I think he certainly wants China to be a dominant global power, you know, moving forward. And then I think related to that, he's made it very clear that the foreign ministry is there to serve the interests of the Chinese Communist Party. And so we've seen the shift in China's foreign policy to a much more aggressive assertion of China's national interests. And I think that's part of a generational shift. I think there's a generation in China that is kind of proud of their achievements. They feel, you know, they've been pushed around by the West for too long. He clearly seems to believe that China is rising while America's declining. And under those circumstances, it's a good opportunity for China to push more aggressively its own interests. But as you said, I mean, that does sort of run counter to other intentions to portray itself as an attractive model for other countries. And I think we've seen in a number of surveys undertaken around the world that not just in Western countries, but in a number of other countries, Chinese popularity has fallen. Personally, I don't, but I know some people do. And in fact, recently, US intelligence is saying that it may even be within the next year or so. I'm not convinced for a number of reasons. I think first of all, I think Beijing, looking at the conflict in Ukraine, has realized how problematic any military invasion of Taiwan would be in the short term. I think they've been taken aback by the strength and solidity of the Western sanctions against Russia, and particularly the impact in the financial sector, which is incredibly important for China to remain internationally engaged. I think secondly, I think that Xi Jinping and probably his military feel that time is on their side. There's no need to rush with this. I mean, I know they've set, ultimately Xi Jinping sets the deadline of 2049, they'll be part of a harmonious, glorious China. But I don't really see evidence coming from the very top that they're in a hurry. I think they feel the more time they take, the more they can build their resources, the more they can build their capabilities. You know, they can watch for weaknesses in the West and maybe areas they can exploit to prevent tough Western actions that might be undertaken to combat China in terms of aggressive actions against Taiwan. So, I mean, some other people have said, you know, 2027, because it's the 100th anniversary of the founding of the Red Army. Again, unless things seriously deteriorate, I would be surprised. I think for me, the worst case scenario is an accident that happens at the local level and then escalates up to a point where neither Washington, Beijing, nor Taipei can control it. And there I think there's a danger because there are no real guardrails to prevent the situation spiraling out of control. At least, you know, the height of the Cold War with the Soviet Union, there were protocols, there were guardrails if certain events happened. And I think the arrogance of Beijing and Washington is preventing the two sides from really getting down to serious discussions on that. I think it did. I mean, I think at one level it was a gift to the People's Liberation Army because it gave them the opportunity to undertake kind of military exercises that I think they might not have been able to do absent Pelosi's visit. So it was a plus for them in that sense. I think it's also, I don't think the Pelosi visit specifically has changed, but I do think over time there's been a building momentum for Washington to be much clearer in terms of its attitude towards China. And I think sort of Pelosi's visit maybe sort of pushed some of that forward. That while the White House, of course, tried to prevent the visit, a lot of politicians were supportive of it, and it certainly played well in US domestic politics. But if you look most recently, I think Washington has made it very clear that they see the mainland as the biggest threat to US power moving forward. We see that with the October 7 regulation limiting export of chips and superconductors and so forth. We see it with the latest national strategy review. But what I don't see, and I think this is important for Taiwan, is a clear consideration of what are Taiwan's interests in this, and are they being taken into account with the kinds of actions that Washington is undertaking. Well, it doesn't have a lot of choice. I mean, obviously, it legitimizes, I think, the import of more advanced military equipment from the West, particularly the United States. I think it is also leading to a situation for more US engagement with training of Taiwanese forces. So, I mean, I think that's one level at which it can respond is by, you know, increasing combat readiness, including, you know, entrepreneurs giving money for civil defense forces and so on. But I think at a second level, I think there's work that Taiwan can do in making its case much more clear in the international community, and particularly in Washington. You know, what is the value of helping Taiwan defend itself beyond just saying, well, it's a democracy, we've been friends for, you know, a long period of time. I mean, I think to also approach it from the aspect of security. You know, what happens to US security were, God forbid, Taiwan to fall, for example. So I think there's things that Taiwan can do in that area as well. And, you know, Taiwan has a lot of good stories to tell. So I think finding ways to get more of those stories out is important. I think if they invade Taiwan, yes. Not by everybody, of course. I mean, China has plenty of friends. And we've seen that with the Russian invasion of Ukraine. There's a number of countries that either supported it or refused to criticize it and want to stay out of things. So, you know, globally, we'd see the same reaction. But I think in terms of countries with assets and power, I think there would be an extremely strong backlash. If it was short of an invasion, sort of squeezing Taiwan economically, diplomatically, then it's harder to say how strong the reaction from the West would be. But I think if you're talking about an actual invasion, I don't think the West would have any choice but to implement as tough a sanctions as it possibly could. And you know, remember how much, despite China wanting to go its own way, it is still extraordinarily reliant on Western technologies, the Western global financial system. And if those were pulled away from it, those would have extremely strong impacts on China's development prospects. You know, I think, again, we have to be really careful because there are countries in the world which benefit greatly from China's presence and investment. Certain countries in Africa, parts of Southeast Asia, Latin America. I think for most of those countries, though, what they do not want is to have to choose, you know, between the United States of America or China. But the way I think both America and China are moving, it's becoming almost inevitable you're going to have to side with one or the other. And that, I think, is going to create problems for Chinese diplomacy. I mean, if we look, even though it's the most economically important country for, in terms of trade, for the vast majority of countries around the world, it's a very kind of thin level of engagement. And I don't think it's been followed by kind of strong support and appreciation of China more broadly. So I think sort of looking forward, it's going to be difficult if it maintains its current approach, and particularly more aggressive approach in terms of pursuing its national interests and wanting to set more of the global agenda. If it's not going to do that in partnership with others, I think we're going to see pushback.